Food allergy classification. Food hypersensitivity can be divided into immune-mediated food allergy and non-immune-mediated food allergy. The immune-mediated food allergy can be IgE-mediated or non-IgE-mediated. We can use this simple classification to divide food hypersensitivity in immune-mediated food allergy that can be IgE-mediated or not, and non-immune-mediated food allergy. It's important to make a distinction between food allergy and food intolerance. Allergy is an adverse health effect arising from a specific immune response that occurs reproducibly on exposure to a given food. So every time that the person eats that specific kind of food, he has the same reaction. Food intolerance is a non-immune reaction that includes metabolic, toxic, pharmacologic, and undefined mechanisms. For example, histamine can cause ADH. The data present in literature are generally supporting an increase in prevalence in food allergy, and specifically 8% in children and 5% in adults. The risk factors are: atopy is the first one. We know that atopy is the genetic predisposition to produce IgE against common antigens present in the environment, such as pollen or house dust mite. Other possible risk factors are factors that increase the absorption of proteins, such as exercise, NSAIDs, and alcohol. The factors that increase the severity of reactions, such as asthma comorbidity. That is why children with food allergy and concomitant asthma should have an epinephrine auto-injector to be able to treat a severe reaction. We have also potential rectifiable risk factors such as vitamin D insufficiency, unhealthy dietary fat, obesity, increased hygiene, and timing of exposure to foods. For example, in the USA, the increased exposure to peanuts during the first year of life is associated with an increased development of allergies. The pathogenetic mechanism. The real food allergy is an IgE-mediated mechanism, and it is a typical allergic reaction with an acute onset. The clinical manifestations are urticaria angioedema. Urticaria is characterized by the presence of wheals that last a few minutes to a few hours and finally disappear without leaving any sign. Angioedema is instead a swelling of the deeper part of the skin. We have also oral allergy syndrome, which is characterized by itching at the level of the oral mucosa that follows the ingestion of food. When the patient ingests this food, starts to feel itching inside the mouth. We have also rhinitis, asthma, so the person can have a respiratory symptom after food ingestion. Can have anaphylaxis, which is the most severe form of allergic reaction to food IgE-mediated. We have food-associated exercise-induced anaphylaxis, which is a very particular clinical entity, and it is characterized by the fact that the food alone is not enough to cause an anaphylactic reaction, but also very strong and heavy exercise concomitants should be present. After this typical IgE-mediated hypersensitivity, we have some clinical entities that combine IgE-mediated and cell-mediated mechanisms. Typically, they are atopic dermatitis, which is an inflammation of the skin that is triggered by many factors, and especially by some food in children. We have eosinophilic gastroenteropathies. These are eosinophilic esophagitis and gastroenteritis. And in these patients, it's always useful to perform an allergic assessment, because some persons have an association between the ingestion of some food and the inflammation of the GI tract. Behind this, there are some cell-mediated food hypersensitivity reactions, which are mainly happening in children and usually due to milk ingestion, and are represented by dietary protein enterocolitis, dietary protein proctitis. Here you can see urticaria, which typically comes and goes and doesn't last more than 24 hours. Here we see angioedema, which is characterized by swelling of the skin, but it occurs more deeply into the skin compared to urticaria. In children, the most common foods implied in food allergies are milk, eggs, and peanuts, while in adults, milk and eggs are not usually present. This means that in adults, we can become tolerant to some foods we were previously intolerant to, And when a little child receives a diagnosis of allergy to eggs or milk, it needs to be reassessed at the age of 6, for example, to understand if tolerance has occurred and the food can be reintegrated in his diet. Other foods that become very important in adults are all the nuts and derivatives, fish and shellfish, wheat associated to exercise, and sesame, in particular associated with anaphylaxis. We have also food-dependent exercise-induced anaphylaxis, which is a condition typically presenting more often in teenagers and young adults. When exercise is performed 10 minutes to 4 hours after food ingestion, 10 minutes to 1 hour, or 10 minutes to 1 hour before it. So, either before or after food. There are two major causes, that are shellfish and wheat, and also lipid transfer protein, that is an allergen contained in a lot of vegetables. The patient presents all the typical signs of anaphylaxis, which are urticaria, angioedema, respiratory and gastrointestinal signs, and anaphylaxis. This condition in general happens just when food ingestion is associated with exercise, and this can be explained by the fact that exercise increases the absorption of food proteins. Food allergic subjects were divided in two groups. Type 1, where food is the first sensitizer. The allergy reaction is mainly given by fish, shrimp, snail, egg, meat, and anisakis. It is a parasite that infects fish. Fruits and vegetables and cereals. We have type 2, which is characterized by pollen food allergy syndrome, latex fluid allergy syndrome, celery, mugwort, spice syndrome. Lipid transfer protein is a group of allergens that cause oral allergic syndromes, but could also cause generalized reactions from urticaria to anaphylaxis. And the characteristic of LTP is that it is stable at high temperature and to pepsinogen, so despite cooking food, you can still have the reaction. This is different compared to other kinds of allergic proteins that are not stable at high temperature and pepsin digestion, and so they could eat uncooked cooked food but not raw food. There is a high level of LTP in the peel of fruit and vegetables, and particularly peach is very rich of them, and we also use it as a marker to test it. Peach is the marker for sensitization to LTP. This sensitization is not due to a cross-reactivity to aeroallergen, and so it can occur in a person who has not a respiratory allergy. When we perform IgE assessment of specific IgE, there is the possibility to assess LTP using PRO-P3. Prophylins. Prophylin is a different allergen that can be found mainly in vegetables. We spoke about it last time. Okay. If present, typically symptoms are oral allergic syndrome with raw fruits and vegetables. Prophylin is a panallergen widespread among fruits and vegetables. We suspected sensitization when we found a widespread allergy to fruit and vegetables. Diagnosis. When a person comes and reports some symptoms that are specific for food allergy, we should follow some steps. Clinical history in particular is important to ask about recognized triggers such as physical exercise, NSAIDs, and other possible ones that usually the patient doesn't tell you if you don't specifically ask it. We have physical examination, which many times is normal because in the majority of cases the patient is coming when he's fine and without the reaction in the acute situation. So basically physical examination is just to exclude other possible types of disease. We have SPT skin prick test. It's performed with commercial extracts and fresh food when the extract is not available. We have total plus specific IgE assessment, performed when we didn't reach a diagnosis in other ways and after in vivo analysis has been performed. Natural extracts and recombinant allergens are tested. We have elimination diet after 3-4 weeks. After this first battery of tests, if we think to have reached a diagnosis, we proceed with the elimination of the source of allergy from the diet for 3-4 weeks and observe if the patient has no more reactions. A food challenge, which can be made open, that is when both the patient and the doctor know what is given to the patient. can be single blind, that is when the doctor knows what he's giving to the patient but the patient doesn't know. And finally double blind, but neither the patient nor the physician knows what the patient is taking. The double blind approach is the gold standard for food allergy diagnosis. We have also also elimination from the diet, and we have other tests that are not used in the routine but that can be used in some specific cases, that are the ISAC test, that is a highly technological tool for revealing the IgE antibody profile of the subject and measures IgE antibodies for 112 components for 51 allergens. This could be helpful when all the other tests were not convincing and you want a complete allergen profile of the subject. This test actually is more useful for older people who are not allergologists and need a more detailed and standardized way to arrive to the diagnosis, because actually most of the times for allergologists the other tests are enough. We have basophil activation test that evaluates the flow cytometry, the basophil's activation by flow. That evaluates by flow cytometry the basophil's activation when put in contact with an allergenic stimulus, and we usually see an increase in expression of CD63 and CD203. It is interesting when the mechanism is uncertain and when we suspect, for example, that the hypersensitivity is given by specific IgG. Activation of basophils can be given by different mechanisms, and when IgE has not been reassessed, we can suspect that there are other mechanisms involved, and typically in these cases the test is not looking for the mechanism involved, but directly to the results of hypersensitivity and so to the activation of effector cells. Another test used specifically in children is the atopy patch test, and it consists in putting some food on the back and leave it for 48 to 72 hours, and observe if there is a delayed reaction. This kind of test is very useful when you suspect, for example, an association between food ingestion and atopic dermatitis, or when you suspect a correlation between food ingestion and gastrointestinal delayed symptoms. It's very important to remember that all other tests that are performed to diagnose food intolerance are not scientifically proven, and they only create problems to patients because they lead to some restrictive diets that are not scientifically useful for the patient. Many patients that arrive to us have already undergone these types of tests that, however, are totally not useful, such as VEGA test, DRIA test, cytotoxic test, iridology error analysis, and specific IgG for foods. Food allergy management. Once the diagnosis of food intolerance is proven, the person has to exclude this food. When it occurs in children, particularly with milk and eggs, you may use some specific oral tolerance induction protocols. And for example, tolerate this food before the natural tolerance would have occurred. There are a lot of studies going on in this specific field of research involving specific immunotherapy, sublingual or epicutaneous, and modified hypoallergenic foods. For example, for peanuts, they are reaching this goal, creating a peanut that is lacking the principal allergens. We have also drugs hypersensitivity reactions. We have, for example, adverse drug reaction, which can be classified based on pathogenesis in predictable and non-predictable. The predictable symptoms are intolerance or idiosyncrasy, and we have to know it because if the patient tell us, for instance, that when he takes aspirin he has nose bleedings, it is something predictable and expected, while if the patient tells you that when he takes aspirins he feels asthma, it is not predictable and can be defined as an unpredictable or hypersensitivity reaction. In this case, not predictable reactions are divided into allergic and pseudoallergic, but however in both, the immune-mediated mechanism is involved. As we said last time, also drug reactions can be explained by a type 1 IgE-mediated mechanism with immediate reactions, and also by type 4 or cell-mediated mechanisms. In a lot of cases in the field of drug allergies, all the mechanisms are associated, and we are therefore not able to make strict divisions. we have drug allergy mechanisms. Speaking about mechanisms, we can find IgE-mediated symptoms and cell-mediated mechanisms that could also be very severe reaction, plus less commonly IgG and complement-mediated reactions. IgE-mediated drug reactions can be urticaria, angioedema, anaphylaxis, bronchospasm. The main types of T-cell-mediated drug allergy are maculopapular exanthem, Steven Johnson syndrome, toxic epidermal necrolysis, acute generalized exanthematous pustulosis, drug reaction with eosinophilia and systemic symptoms, nephritis, pancreatitis, colitis, pneumonitis, and hepatitis. Less commonly, we can have IgG and complement-mediated drug allergy, and in this case, we prevalently find blood cell dyscrasia, hemolytic anemia, thrombocytopenia, agranulocytosis, vasculitis, drug-induced autoimmunity in SLE and pemphigus. We have also drug hypersensitivity reaction timing, which can be subdivided. Drug hypersensitivity reactions can be subdivided into immediate, when occur within 1 hour from the assumption of the drug, delayed when they occur after 24 hours, and accelerated if after 1 hour but before 24 hours. We have said that the main symptoms of the immediate reaction are the one listed here in the image. Now we have said that the main symptoms of the immediate reaction are urticaria and anaphylactic shock, while for what regards non-delayed immune reaction, the main symptom is maculopapular rash. These three symptoms together account for 88% of the reactions. Epidemiology. The main drugs implied in hypersensitivity reactions are the ones listed here in the image. The two main important ones are beta-lactams and NSAIDs. We will see that in beta-lactams allergy we have a really IgE-mediated hypersensitivity mechanism, while in NSAIDs, it's not an IgE-mediated mechanism in the majority of cases. Other antibiotics are involved in 21.7% of cases, and they account mainly for sulfa allergies and quinolones allergy. Then we can have radiocontrast media, paracetamol, corticosteroids, local anesthetics, opiates, and others. IgE clinical presentation. We have a rapidly appearing urticaria, rapidly appearing angioedema, mostly periorbital oral genital swellings with moderate pruritus in association with generalized urticaria. We have gastrointestinal symptoms like cramps, diarrhea, and vomiting. We have anaphylaxis and anaphylactic shock. We have T-cell mediated exanthems like bullous exanthema, maculopapular exanthema, acute generalized exanthematous pustulosis, which is the most severe form. Acute generalized exanthematous pustulosis is a severe drug reaction, but if promptly recognized and the drug is suspended, we can recover in a couple of days. Many drugs can induce this type of reaction, but mainly, again, antibiotics and NSAIDs. We have erythema multiforme, which is a target lesion of iris lesions that appear within 72 hours period and begins on the extremities. The lesions remain in a fixed location for at least 7 days and then start to heal. We have DRESS, which is instead characterized, which is a different type of drug in reaction with eosinophilia and systemic symptoms. It's characterized by an itchy rash, fever, eosinophilia, lymphadenopathy, liver toxicity, and kidney failure. In a lot of cases, herpes virus 6 seems to be involved in this severe reaction to drugs. Usually antibiotics are the cause of these reactions, and diagnosis may be confused with the normal symptoms of the infection. We have Steven Johnson syndrome, which is characterized by an involvement of skin, but particularly of oral and genital mucosa. This is a life-threatening reaction and is not rare. It's very important to check the mucosa when we have a reaction on the skin. This syndrome is mainly linked to the use of antibiotics, anticonvulsants, and NSAIDs. In this case, the best treatment we can use is to treat these people exactly in the same way as burn patients. FLEL syndrome, which is quite similar to Steven Johnson, but while in Steven Johnson you have less than 30% of this epithelialization of the skin. In LEL, we have more than 30% of this epithelialization, and obviously the risk to die is much higher. Mortality in severe delayed drug hypersensitivity reactions. Mortality in severe delayed drug hypersensitivity reaction is non-negligible, and you can see that in this kind of toxic epidermal necrolysis, that is Lyell syndrome, it can reach up to 30%, so very high percentage. The most important thing in this kind of severe drug reaction is to assess the responsible drug, and is not so easy in a hospital setting, because many times the patient is taking a large number of medications, all recently introduced to treat the infection. Basically, you have to decide what is more severe for the patient, either eliminate some drugs or let the reaction proceed. Truly an uneasy situation to be managed. We have also drug variant interactions. In the field of drug reactions, interactions between viruses and drugs are very common, and the prototype of this kind of situation is the mononucleosis rash in a patient treated with ampicillin or amoxicillin. This is very common between children with ABV, where ABV is mimicking a bacterial infection, and so usually an antibiotic therapy is initiated, usually penicillin, and the virus can accelerate the sensitization to penicillin. So in these cases, when in the clinical history the patient says that he started amoxicillin therapy, he developed a rash, and after has been diagnosed with EBV infection, even if all the examinations result negative, you have to be very careful and suspect everything, because it is probable that he will be sensitized, and it is better to avoid the drug. When the patient arrives with a suspected drug reaction, we need to exclude all the possible other possible differential diagnoses and reactions for infections, etc. Anticonvulsants. They are one of the major causes of hypersensitivity reactions, together with antibiotics, NSAIDs, and iodinated contrast media. They can cause very severe manifestations such as DRESS, Stevens-Johnson, and TEN. In the real life, we see many cases of patients treated in neurosurgery with anticonvulsant drugs, and that shows hypersensitivity problems. The three main drugs used are carbamazepine, lamotrigine, and phenobarbital. Anticonvulsants can cause mild to very severe manifestations like DHIS and DRESS and Stevens-Johnson and TEN. Anticonvulsant hypersensitivity syndrome can occur in 1 over 3,000 treated persons. Immunogenetic risk factors are defined in Chinese. Symptoms differ from drug to drug. Exanthema, hepatitis, nephritis, fever, signs of capillary leak syndrome, similar to symptoms observed in a cytokine storm. We have laboratory tests, so lymphocytosis and eosinophils in more than 70% of cases. High cytokines, IL-5 and interferon gamma, in serum, increase in ALT-AST, and in serum creatinine. Often in the third week, there is the reappearance of symptoms in the absence of drug intake due to reactivation of HHV6 and other herpes viruses, CMV, EBV, HHV6-7. For treatment, we use corticosteroids for hepatitis. Use of high-dose IgG replacement therapy is controversial. We have also beta-lactam antibiotics, which are the most frequent causes of allergic reactions, penicillin, cephalosporin, and amoxicillin. They are able to cause more frequently IgE-mediated reactions, but also cell-mediated allergic diseases. The patient has allergen sensitization for the whole category of drugs, and we need to pay attention to cross-reactivity. We have beta-lactams. Beta-lactam are 2-8% of hospitalized patients develop allergies. They are apt and able to cause all forms of drug allergies. Cross-reactivity between penicillin and cephalosporins, because of a common ring, is present. For 11% in immediate reaction with documented type 1 allergy, predominantly in early studies for first generation cephalosporins, very rare and negligible in delayed reactions. Recommendation for skin testing to penicillins and suspected cephalosporin. Cross-reactivity. Cross-reactivity exists at a low rate, and it's important to remember that if after some years we will find in front of a patient that really needs the drug, it's better to perform some tests in order to exclude the cross-reactivity, with the risk that the patient has become allergic also to the similar family. In a patient who has already presented a typical IgE-mediated reaction to one of them, it's better to go deeply and test him for the possible allergies. In particular, for penicillin, the risk of an IgE-mediated allergy exists, and so even if it's a minor reaction, you should perform step-by-step administration of it. If a person comes to you saying that 10 years before he developed a rash after some days of amoxicillin treatment and they stopped it, then you have some problems. In fact, if the reaction continued years before, the subject can also result negative to tests, because the farther you go from the reaction, the more skin prick tests and specific IgE disappears. So you need to perform twice the test in order to allow the system to resensitize himself and to retest him after 1 month in order to verify that the resensitization has not occurred. You decide to resensitize a patient, also depending on other factors like the age of the person, and you try to do it just if the patient really needs the drug. Otherwise, you can shift to another drug without problems, because it takes a lot of time and sensitization can be lost during years, but just upon testing it, while in reality it's still present. To sum up, basically you need to check if there is no possibility that the patient, despite being negative to the test, will respond again to the drug, creating an allergic reaction. We have also sulfonamides, such as sulfamethoxazole, mainly given in combination with trimethoprim-cotrimoxazole. Around 2-4% of hospitalized patients develop allergies, but up to 50% of HIV-infected patients treated for pneumocystis jirovecii prophylaxis, sulfamethoxazole can become an apten, able to cause all forms of drug allergies. These are reactions, exanthema 4A and 5D, mainly due to a 2PI concept, namely a direct stimulation of TCR by sulfamethoxazole. We also need to remember that there are a lot of drugs containing sulfa components, from diuretics to antibiotics, and so when subject shows this type of reaction, you should advise him to perform tests for whatever kind of these drugs sulfa components containing. Perioperative anaphylaxis. It occurs in 1 over 10,000, 2,000 anesthetic procedures and 1 over 6,500 administrations of neuromuscular blocking agents. Symptoms reach from mild urticaria to death due to anaphylactic shock. 3-10% of perioperative death are due to such reactions. The severe reactions may involve only one system, most commonly the cardiovascular system. About 60% of the immediate hypersensitivity reactions occurring during anesthesia are IgE-mediated, but 50% occur in persons not previously exposed to anesthesia. 28% have recurrent symptoms in the following 8 years. In these cases, we can hypothesize the causes of perioperative anaphylaxis. It can have NBAs, so neuromuscular blocking agents are accounting for the highest prevalent percentage, from 50-70% of cases. We have latex, it is the second place where we found latex allergy. We have antibiotic, which is the third ranking place for antibiotic allergy development. We have less common causes like colloids, protein, protamine, antiseptics, and dyes. We have also radio contrast media. These are common, becoming more and more often causes of hypersensitivity reaction because of their widespread use in the clinical practice. The most commonly involved ones are especially iodinated contrast media performed in CT scan. Contrast media are widely applied. There are three iodinated phenyl ring structures rapidly excreted by the urine. They cause immediate, sometimes even lethal reactions. These were more frequent with ionic contrast media. The newer non-ionic dimers cause less side effects, less than 1%. But delayed, mostly mild reactions occur with them as well, mainly with non-ionic dimers in 2-4% of cases. About 50% of contrast media-induced immediate and delayed reactions appear upon the first exposure. Trodermal skin test with a battery of contrast media can be positive with immediate and delayed reactions. The highest sensitivity is seen 2-6 months after the reaction. Cross-reactivity is very common in delayed, less common in immediate reactions. Skin tests may help in the identification of an alternative tolerated contrast medium. NSAIDs hypersensitivity. You can have pseudoallergic reactions, not IgE-mediated, which are reactions due to their mechanism of action of cyclooxygenase inhibition with a consequent increase of leukotrienes. You have allergic reactions that are IgE-mediated. Type 5 is urticaria angioedema to a single NSAID. Type 6 is anaphylaxis to a single NSAID, not aspirin. Incidence of aspirin hypersensitivity in the general population is 0.6-2.5%. In adult asthmatics is 4.3%-11%. Clinical phenotypes are NSAIDs, aspirin as an exacerbated respiratory disease or aspirin-induced asthma. We can have an underlying asthma, sinusitis, nasal polyposis in the Weidel Sumters triad. We can have aspirin, so aspirin-induced urticaria angioedema. You can have underlying chronic idiopathic urticaria, where you have NSAIDs-induced urticaria angioedema anaphylaxis. So hypothesize an IgE-mediated mechanism. You have no underlying risk factors, like in NSAIDs single reactors. You can have genetic risk factors, like in IHLA associations and genetic polymorphisms, in aspirin-sensitive asthma and urticaria angioedema in certain populations. Slides below, we can see and understand which tests are available before immediate and non-immediate reactions. In vitro test in acute phase consists in the assessment of tryptase, that is the main mediator released by histamine during immediate reactions. In the late phase instead, after the ending of the reactions, you could perform assessment of specific IgE, but only for few drugs, and in particular for beta-lactam drugs. It is not available for other kind of drugs. Other in vitro possible tests are the basophil activation test and the lymphocyte transformation test, and we will discuss about these two later in the lesson. In vivo tests include the skin prick test and challenge. So in the acute phase, in vitro, we can use serum tryptase and plasma histamine, while in the late phase, we can use serum-specific IgE, basophil activation test, or lymphocyte transformation test. While in vivo, we can perform a skin test or challenge. This for immediate reactions to beta-lactams. In non-immediate reactions to beta-lactams, in vitro we can use, in the acute phase, Coombs test, hemolysis test, complement factors assays, circulating immune complex assays. In the late phase, in vitro we can use lymphocyte transformation test, while in vivo we can use delayed reading skin test, patch test, and challenge. Here in this table on the left, we have the representation of the time course of serum tryptase, and you can see that at the beginning, after 60 minutes from the start of the reaction, we have reached the peak of tryptase, and then we start to descend after 90 minutes. Tryptase is a very useful marker for anaphylaxis and is used in routine settings because there is a quite wide range in which to use it. The contrary is true for plasma histamine, that has a very narrow range of circulation in the blood and is not used because really low reliable. Tryptase can instead be used for both anaphylaxis but also septic shock, so it's important to say that tryptase is a marker of acute IgE mediated reactions, and if you find it high during the reaction, you should perform a second measurement after its resolution. The reaction can be an isolated reaction in a normal patient with no other underlying pathology, but could also be due to mast cells activation that could lead to the deposition of having some allergic reactions, to the predispositions of having some allergic reactions. The determination of the tryptase during the reaction is the first assessment we should do. If you find it over 20 micrograms per liter, you will have the confirmation of the allergic IgE mediated reaction, and only when you perform it the second time after a few days, you can understand if the value has gone back to normal range, that is less than less than 10 micrograms per liter, and be able to say if it was just an acute allergic reaction, while if you find this value again elevated, you are able to say that this subject can have a mast cell activation disorder. If this value is always constantly over 20 micrograms per liter, the patient has to be studied with an osteomedullary biopsy with the suspect of mastocytosis. Systemic mastocytosis is always to be kept in consideration when tryptase values are like this. So risk patients are where we have elevated baseline levels, underlying mastocytosis, tryptase levels more than 10 micrograms per liter. Skin prick test. It's specific, sensitive, simple to perform, rapid. Results are in 15-20 minutes and educational for the patient. Skin prick test for drugs is advisable, especially in the case of antibiotics, anesthetics and contrast media. For NSAIDs, it's not standardized, and so it's better not to use it because we would like to avoid having some false positives or false negative results. In vivo tests include also intradermal skin test. Typically, it is more sensitive than the skin prick test alone, and it is performed when SPT is negative. So the first step is the skin prick test. And after it, if negative, we use intradermal skin test at increasing concentrations. It's more sensitive than skin prick test, may induce false positive reactions, may induce systemic reactions, and should be done only if the skin prick test is negative and the allergen is highly suspect. After this first step in vivo diagnosis, you have to consider that for penicillins you have immediate reactions, drug-specific IgE tests, only for this specific kind of drugs. There are various ones. Also, basophil activation test is available and is a very helpful in vitro diagnostic tool, especially when no other tests are available, for example in the case of anesthetics or NSAIDs, when reactions are severe and you prefer to help the diagnosis with an in vitro test. Flow cytometric basophil activation tests, like FAST, FlowCast or BasoTest, they are based on the flow cytometric evaluation of CD63 on blood basophils and activation molecule appearing following incubation of blood basophils with drugs or other allergens in vitro. They have beta-lactams with a sensitivity of 50%, specificity of 93% when compared to FEIA, etc., etc. We have also delayed reactions lymphocyte transformation test, which measures the proliferation of T cells to a drug in vitro. And this is not available in a routine setting, but it would be very helpful in a hypersensitivity reaction. So, in all cases where delayed T cell hypersensitivity mechanisms is involved, this is the only in vitro analysis that could be helpful for the diagnosis. Advantage, it's applicable to many different drugs with different immune reactions, as drug-specific T cells are almost always involved in drug hypersensitivity reactions. Disadvantages are, test per se is rather cumbersome and technically demanding, and sensitivity is limited. In vivo test instead include the patch test, which is the same we use for contact allergic dermatitis, so it is the only test routinely performed in the diagnosis of delayed reactions. Other drug tests are drug patch tests are positive in 30 to 50% of patients that who have developed a cutaneous drug eruption. The advantages are usually positive in AGEP, maculopapular rash, photodermatosis, lichenoid rash, fixed drug eruption. Frequently positive for beta-lactam antibiotics, especially amoxicillin, cotrimoxazole, corticosteroids, heparin derivatives, prostamycin, carbamazepine, diltiazem, diazepam, hydroxyzine, pseudoephedrine, tetrazepam. Disadvantages are low sensitivity, at best 50%, and lack of standardized test reagents. We have drug provocation test, indicated first of all to exclude hypersensitivity in a non-suggestive history or non-specific symptoms, and so when the patient is referring some symptoms that you don't think linked to hypersensitivity, but you are not able to exclude it completely. So in the indications are exclude hypersensitivity in non-suggestive history or non-specific symptoms, provide safe pharmacologically and or structurally non-related drugs in proven hypersensitivity, such as in beta-lactam antibiotics. Exclude cross-reactivity of related drugs in proven hypersensitivity, such as in cephalosporin, in penicillin allergic, and definitive diagnosis in suggestive history with negative, non-conclusive, or non-available allergological tests. Contraindications are pregnant women, comorbidity where DPT may provoke stimulation, situation beyond medical control, such as in acute infection, uncontrolled asthma, underlying cardiac, hepatic, renal disease, then immunobolus drug eruption, severe systemic initial reaction. The treatment is stop the suspected drugs, resuscitation in serious reactions like airway breathing circulation in anaphylaxis. The drugs that can be used are antihistamine, can be IV or oral, intramuscular epinephrine for anaphylaxis, systemic corticosteroids, high dose IVIG, 1 gram per kilogram per day for 2 days, for early 10 and Stevens-Johnson syndrome overlapped, and 10. Emollients and skin care, hydration and prevention of skin superinfection, 10. Intravenous immunoglobulin can be very important to reinforce the immune system in this period, in which we have a very high risk of death. Desensitization, the concept is that it is mainly useful in some situations in which the culprit drug has to be administered, for example, in the case of chemotherapeutics, such as platinum salts. From the oncological point of view, if the drug is really giving a better profile to the patient, there are some proposals to administer the drug to desensitize the patient. This is done just in the case in which the drug cannot be substituted. Making a patient tolerant to a drug he/she is allergic to, when there are no reasonable alternatives, contraindicated in system Stevens-Johnson syndrome, and 10. Not contraindicated in anaphylaxis, patients still consider allergic to the drug. Have a rapid desensitization with immediate hypersensitivity, or a slow desensitization with a delayed hypersensitivity. Allopurinol, sulfasalazine, TB drugs, and SMX.